psalm books, please turn to 127, and let's stand and sing with the choir, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. 127. If you would this evening, we're delighted you're here. Let's pray together.
Father, thank you for this evening. I pray that you'd please speak to every heart. Have your will and your way done in this service. We pray that you would meet with us in a special way tonight. Give power to the preacher and lift him up on high, we ask, and help him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, let me have your attention, please, if you remain standing with us. We're going to fellowship just here in just a few minutes. We have several things we're going to do different tonight. We've got some folks visiting right over here. Some folks in the back visiting with us, some folks in the middle section, and some folks from the left over here, and I want you to wire them out. I want you to shake their hand to just make them feel so welcome. You want me to do that for me? All right, so the choir comes down, shake hands with everybody you see. Just shake hands with them. Tell them it's good to see them. Good to see them. You're at Mount Pisgah Baptist Church tonight. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate you being here. All right, just a few things I need to tell you about tonight. First of all, after church tonight, there's a meeting of the support group back in the Joy Sunday School Room when the services are over. Also on Tuesday, if you work at the print shop, our cook's going to be busy driving a bus for Vacation Bible School, so bring sandwiches. And usually you like to bring two, because I usually eat up there, so bring two sandwiches apiece. Amen? If you do that, please. Also, brother, is there a meeting tonight, Vacation Bible School Workers, Tom? Also, we'll use the overflow room for the meeting of Vacation Bible School Workers after church tonight. They'll meet in the overflow room just to my left here at the back. HB wanted me also to announce that we have four or five openings left for the trip to Mexico, our missionary trip to Mexico. There's four or five openings left if you'd like to go. Was it $160? $160? You'll enjoy it, a chartered bus, air conditioning, and going to be traveling in style. You'll like it. So if you'd like to go on that tuition trip, we'd like for you to go. Got a lot we're going to try to do tonight, okay? My Good Deed of the Week award this week. There's certain people that do things around here that you never even see that are done, that get done. And I appreciate them, and I've never said anything publicly about what they've done. Three of these people. But Isella Prater's our church. This is for you. All right. Tommy Marler. Is Tommy here? He's out smoking? Tell him to come in. And Barry Stiltner. Come here. Where's Barry? I saw them come in. They take care of our Sunday school. You never see those people. Never see them. They do a good job. Always here. Up here, Tommy. If you hadn't been smoking outside, we'd have been up here sooner. You left them at home. All right. Thank you. Raise them. And Kay Carter. Kay, this is for you. Kay Carter Tropper. Yes, this is for Kay. She plays the instruments for us. She wasn't here. Kay, this is for you. Brother Tom Green, I'm not going to embarrass him. I don't want to do that. This is Tom and Ginger's last Sunday night with us at our church. I recommended him to a church in Indiana, Pennsylvania. And after he went up there and preached for him a few times, and they talked, the church voted to take him to work there. And he'll be assuming the pastor of that church, I assume he will, by January. It's a good church. It's a man that I've known for years. And when he called me, he said he needs someone to help him. I felt like Brother Green could be a good man to take over that church. And I recommended him. And we appreciate him. We have several families that are going to be leaving us this summer. Travis and Michelle, my son and daughter-in-law, are moving to Texas. Morgan's going to stay here. Stephen Trail is going back to New Jersey. Daryl and Lynn Duncan and their children, Jessica and Allen, are moving to Arizona. Denny and Judy Newbold and their children, Sean and Garrett, are moving to Pennsylvania. Is there anybody else? That's several folks who come Sunday morning, Wednesday, and Sunday nights. And there's folks, we're going to miss those people. And I was wanting to, I didn't know this, for some reason I miscommunicated with Tom, because next Sunday night I want to do something after church and just have a little refreshments. But he's going to be going there to work. He's done an excellent job of hard labor with our young people. I mean, when you have 25, 30 young people out on visitation, someone spends some time with them, encourage them. And Wednesday nights, we had as many as 86 on Wednesday nights, teenagers. Does a good job with them. And I appreciate all the things in these 5.5 years that he has volunteered to do. And I didn't ask him to do them, he volunteered. Many of the ministries we have here, Tom thought of and asked me, could he start them? Our bus program, which is a fruitful program, and I appreciate that, and I've told him privately what I'm saying publicly, so this isn't just a put-on, just not me just trying to be nice in public. I've told him how much I appreciate his working with the school and working with our buses and working with our young people, and I appreciate that. And you ought to, too, and you ought to appreciate He saved our church about $20,000 because he played two roles. It's a lot of money. It's a lot of hard work. And If you enjoy seeing these young people that we baptize on Sunday nights, it's a product of his and Tom and Stephen Trail's ministry and some others that work in the bus ministry. And we'll miss his efforts here in his work. He's a hard-working young man. I appreciate him. Didn't say he was perfect, because he's not. But he sure has done a good job for me, and I appreciate it. So I've asked him to sing tonight for us. He's going to sing two songs for us. Then we're going to take up the offering, and then we have about three other songs, and I'll preach, and we're going to baptize, and we'll be out of here, but at least, okay? All right.
Go with me back to where I started from, then I know you would see the miracle of love that took me gently in its embrace and made me what I am today. A sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my place. Breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven, I'm headed for heaven, and I'm just a sinner saved by grace. How could I boast of it? I've ever seen or done, and how could I dare to claim as mine the victories God has won? Where would I be had God not brought me gently to this place? I'm here to say I'm nothing but a sinner saved by grace. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned to death, he took my place. Breath of life I take, I'm loved and forgiven, headed for heaven, and I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Saved your soul. Remember the joy as you gave him full control. But if time has removed the peace you knew there, calling you back to the place you began. Child, child, oh, why do you wander out in the darkness away from just as close as you can. I know I'm redeemed, 'cause I've been to Calvary. Though sometimes I'll falter and I'll fail His will to see, but forgiveness is all mine. In Him I rejoice, because I'm one of His sheep, and His sheep know His voice. Child, child, oh, why do you wander out in the darkness away from the just as close as you can. So walk just as close as you can.
All right, we're going to take up an offering tonight. Our ushers will come. Some of you give us some young men and some here to help us take up the offering tonight. Some of our folks are on vacation that we have to usually use as ushers. Okay, give me two or three people real quick that just want to thank the Lord they get to give. We've never done this before. Amen. Amen. The Lord loveth a cheerful giver. He also accepteth from a grouch. But isn't it wonderful to be able to give? It's more blessed to give than to receive, isn't it? Brother Paul Tropper, come and pray for us.
Father, we thank you for this time to be able to give back something, Lord, that you've given to us so freely. Father, we ask to bless the service this evening. If there's one lost soul here, that they be saved. Father, we especially ask to bless these families that are leaving the church family. Just, Lord, just watch over them and bless them. Give them strength and courage in new positions. Father, just want to say that we love you. Just thank you for every little thing. Amen.
David, God bless you as you give. If you'll move up here behind the piano, please. Stephen, sit on the front row here for me. Our young people can come and give their money tonight. Say a scripture verse. Do either or both, please. Brother the price. If you'll come, let them do that for me, please.
I will come to you.
No man can serve two masters. I am that bread of life, John 6:48.
Jesus me.
All right.
Sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Forgive and ye shall be forgiven.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not fear. Cheerful giver.
Yes, he does.
Onward, Christian soldier.
Very good. Let's give him a big hand this evening. The children may go downstairs to their class this evening.
There are walls made by men, built by friends. Human hands that an enemy can scale and get to you. But there is one protecting me from my greatest enemy. It's a wall that Satan can't break through. Sometimes a wall of grace, sometimes a wall of faith, other times it's with sweet mercy that I need. But the one for which I long, it makes all the others strong. I need a wall of prayer surrounding me. Oh, my brother, when I'm weak, would you stand instead for me and pray a fortress round me strong that can't be moved? And I promise you today, when I bow my knees to pray, I'll do my best to build a wall of prayer for you. Sometimes a wall of grace, sometimes a wall of faith, other times it's sweet mercy that I need. But the one for which I long, it makes all the others strong. I need a wall of prayer surrounding me. Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care. But the one for which I long, it makes all the others strong. I need a wall of prayer surrounding me. I need a wall of prayer surrounding me.
Thank you, Susan. I appreciate that. Appreciate the Spencer family visiting with us, being here with us this Sunday, and they get through about once that one time a year. And I recall those when I was 27 years of age, I became their pastor. It's been 28 years ago, so we've known each other that long and enjoyed the friendship. All right, take your Bibles to Judges chapter 6. Tom, if you'll come back real quick now for us. Judges chapter 6, be finding that for us, please, and we'll be ready in just a moment.
My soul was burdened down with pride. Then the Master came along and he showed me I was wrong. And he placed me on the winning side. Well, I'm on the winning side. I am on the winning side. No more out in sin will I abide. I've enlisted in the fight for the cause of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side. I will never, never fear, for my Lord is always near, and in Him so often I confide. He's the keeper of my soul since I gave to Him control. Now I know I'm on the winning side. Well, I'm on the winning side. I am on the winning side. No more out in sin will I abide. I've enlisted in the fight for the cause of truth and right. Praise the Lord, I'm on the winning side. Praise
out, I'm on the winning side. Amen. I was thinking today, and I'll be there to preach in just a few minutes, and I hope God will give me enough wisdom. I have so much to say tonight. I hope I can say it properly and correctly and not belabor you with a point and get right to it, and I'll do my best in just a minute to do that. Of all the good preachers, I think that would be a good term I could use, that God's let come through our church and be a part of this church and go out of this church. Brother Jerry Prevo, I think I saw his wife here again tonight, and she's been here on Sundays, and you can't go anywhere and mention Jerry's name. Someone doesn't know about him. Isn't that wonderful that God let this church have a part of that? And then in the few short years I've been here, they've been short to me. They've been 16 and a half years. Haven't they been short to you? Three people. Thank you, both of you. I appreciate that. I think of Brother Mike Lamb doing an excellent job there in Parkersburg, West Virginia, run over 400 on Sunday morning. Brother Jonathan Lands just built a new building and running 300-400 people on Sunday mornings. Brother Green will do a good job where he goes. I promise you will. And I'm just thinking today and thankful for that. And we're fortunate, and we're thankful. And this family, the Palmers here, visiting with us. I was talking to them right before church, and you don't go anywhere mention Billy Kelly. Or you mention Oliver Springs, they think of Billy Kelly. And we just appreciate God's goodness to us. Judges chapter 6 and verse number 11, please. If you're able to stand, I want you to. And if you cannot stand, you may remain seated. I'll read a few verses tonight. We've been preaching about Gideon. This is our second message tonight. And we read this story. And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak, which is at Ophrah, that pertaineth unto Joash, the Abiezrite. And his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress. He hid it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? And where be all the miracles which our fathers told us of, saying, Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord hath forsaken us, hath delivered us from the hands of the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, Surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man. Said to him, If now I have found grace in thy sight, then shew me a sign that thou talkest with me. Depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee, and bring forth my present, and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until thou come again. And Gideon went in, and made ready a kid, and unleavened cakes, and an ephod of flour, the flesh put in a basket. And he put the broth in a pot, and brought it out unto him under the oak, and presented it. The angel of God said to him, Take the flesh and the unleavened cakes, and lay them upon the rock, and pour out the broth. And he did so. Then the angel of the Lord put forth the end of the staff of that was in his hand, and he touched the flesh and the unleavened cakes. And there rose up fire out of the rock, and consumed the flesh and the unleavened cakes. Then the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. When Gideon perceived that this was the angel of the Lord, Gideon said, At last, O my Lord, for because I have seen an angel of the Lord face to face. And the Lord said unto him, Peace be unto thee. Fear not, thou shalt not die. And Gideon built an altar there unto the Lord, and he called it Jehovah Shalom. To this day is it yet in Ophrah of the Abiezrite. Father, help me be a blessing. May the Spirit of God give us instruction and wisdom. I want to tell you I love you. Thank you for being so good and gracious and merciful to us. Help us this hour to honor you. I pray in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. Be seated, please, if you would, just for a few minutes. I wished I had time tonight to go back and review the first 10 verses of Judges chapter 6. I hope you can retain or recall some of the things we talked about last Sunday night about Gideon. This was times when the nation was in great ruin. They were in a time when they had done evil. In verse number 1, Judges chapter 6, they had done evil in the sight of the Lord. Because of this, they were prisoners in their own land. They was hiding in caves. They had no power. Gideon was hiding, threshing wheat. You saw that. The Midianites, the Amalekites, and the people from the east were oppressing them. Because I want to tell you, folks, I want to tell you, sin is a terrible master. Say what you want to. You don't possess what you think you ought to possess. because sin is a terrible master. And they were living in great ruins. The Midianites would come in and they'd take away everything they'd worked for. They'd stole their animals away. They'd impoverished them. They'd imprisoned them, and they were in great ruin. Listen to me. And the reason that God introduced us to the great ruin at this time is because redemption is never good till you see what a terrible mess you're in. Amen? And because, listen, I have no problem ever convincing a man to get saved if you'll ever get lost. If you ever realize you're going to hell, you'll be no problem with you getting saved. If you'll ever realize what your sin, the way it affects you, the way it affects others, the way it affects God, you won't have any problem coming to the Redeemer and the Savior. And the trouble is, if you're here tonight and you're lost without God, or you're listening by means of television or radio, and you're lost without God, the reason you've never come to know Him is you've never seen yourself like you need to see yourself as a horrible, hell-deserving sinner, undeserving of any of the grace of God, and you're in a ruin that you cannot fix yourself. And that's where the nation of Israel was at the time of Gideon. What does one need, though, in the time of ruin? What do you need in a time when you're impoverished, imprisoned, as they were? Well, if we were to discuss it in our 20th century, if we almost say education, we'll just educate people about the ruins that they're in. And we can just educate them about the ruins they're in, they can get help from it. But I want to tell you, education isn't the answer to the ruins. Someone would say, well, we teach people how to live in the ruins. They can just live in it and get along with it and let it just be a part of their lives, but that's not the answer. The answer is in this passage of Scripture, and the answer, to make it just brief and simple as I can, the answer is a revelation from God. How God reveals Himself to us. Because God gave a revelation of Himself to Gideon, who was weak, who was confused, who was confounded, whose God's going to rise to be a conqueror and a deliverer of the people, because he got a glimpse and a revelation of who God is, and as God come to visit with him. And I want to tell you something. Our churches would be revived if we got a glimpse of who God was again. Our lives would be enhanced and enriched if once again we get a revelation of who God is, and the might of God and the power of God and the greatness of God and the ability of God. Thank God we've got a God that's able, amen, and a God that's never failed. But about four things tonight. I'll try to be as brief as I can. I don't want to like to rush myself. I'm all the time doing that. But let me get on with it. The care that God showed in the revelation that he gave. The care that God showed. Verses 12 through 13 again. If you look at that with me just for a second. Gideon, the Lord comes to him and he says to him, "Thou mighty man of valor." Now I laugh at that. He's hiding everywhere. We'll talk about that in a few minutes later on down the road. And then God begins to tell him, and Gideon begins to say, "Now Lord, if you're with us, why are we having all the trouble we're having?" You understand that language? You understand? Say amen. Help me. There's two response to this revelation of God. One of them is a proclamation of God's care. That's the first thing. And the second thing is a protest that Gideon gave God about his own words. First of all, the proclamation of God's care. God said, Gideon, and more, this makes my heart rejoice. He said, "I am with thee." I tell you what, I don't know of anything I need more than just the very fact that God is with me. If God be for us, who's it matter who's against us? If God be for us, who can be against us? To be with them is to be for them. Now, Gideon did not realize how much God cared. And a lot of times you don't see God's care either. We just overlook it. For instance, in verses 8 and 9 and 10 of that chapter, they had prayed and God had heard them. Let me ask you a question. Is that a sign of God's caring when he hears your prayer? Answer me. Yes, it is. In answer to their prayer, God had sent them a preacher and to give them instructions in their ruins how to get right with God. So God had already showed his care, but Gideon had just not seen it. And I'm afraid oftentimes in our life, God cares so much, but we fail to see how much God really cares for us. There's a song I love so dearly. I use it at every memorial service that I ever preach, I suppose. And it says this. This is just the last verse of the song, but you'll get the thought of it. It says this. Does Jesus care when I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me? As my sad heart aches and it nearly breaks, does he care enough to be nigh? Then the chorus answers and says, "Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. And though the days were dreary, the long nights weary, thank God, I know my Savior cares." So God came looking, listen to me. Don't you see God's care here? God came looking for Gideon. Gideon wasn't out in public and say, hey, God, I need you. He's hiding somewhere, threshing wheat, and God showed his care to go behind an old oak tree somewhere, hidden somewhere, looking for Gideon because God wanted to show his care for Gideon. And I want to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. What's true of Gideon is true of you and I. I want to tell you, when I got saved, I wasn't looking for God. When I got saved, I wasn't trying to seek after God. I want to tell you, when I got saved, ladies and gentlemen, I wasn't doing that because I want to tell you, but thank God, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. I have not chosen, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, and I have ordained you, and I have sent you forth. So I want to tell you, I didn't come looking for God, but thank God, God came looking for me one time. Thank God for the Holy Spirit of God, who did not get off of my trail, but continually prodded me and kept coming to where I was to reach out to save me by his grace and mercy. That's a proclamation of God's care. That's a protest of God's care. Gideon had a problem. He said, now, Lord, if you be for us, why are we having all this bad times? You know, people have a hard time with God on two different issues. If I've seen this in 32 years, two different issues. Number one, if they're having a hard time, they have a hard time believing that's from God. Or if there's sickness, that's a hard time. It's hard for us to accept that. Or if a death comes, we have a hard time sometimes accepting that. How could that be? If God, listen, here's the question that you hear all the time. Why do bad things happen to? Let me ask you an even harder question. Why do good things happen to bad people? Why is God so gracious to you and me? Why is God so loving to us? Gideon had a problem. First of all, he had a problem with God's justice. He said, why has this befallen us? He's accusing God of being unjust to Israel. Have you ever done that to God? Have you ever, let's be honest, have you ever said, God, I'm trying to serve you. Why am I having such a hard time? Why didn't my marriage work out right? Why did my kids turn out wrong? Why did my husband get so ugly? Come on, wake up, folks. We ain't got all night. Come on. You can blame God for all of it. But I want to tell you, the problem is not God's inadequacy. It's man's iniquity. Verse 1 of chapter 6 again. I didn't believe that I wouldn't get up in the morning and work the days that I work and put the time in I put in and witness people like I witnessed. If I didn't believe God had the power to save them and change their lives or build a church here, we wouldn't be planning on building a 1,300-seat auditorium and spending over $1 million on that. If we didn't believe that God could pay for it and God has the ability to do things. I want to tell you that God has the ability to do everything that God desires to do. But Gideon had the power. He said, where's all the miracles? Where's all the miracles that God's able to do? And I want to tell you that our God's still in the miracle work of business. And God's people said, and had a problem with God's faithfulness. He says in verse number 13, he says, the Lord has forsaken us. Well, the problem was that the Lord had not forsaken them, but they had forsaken the Lord. They were serving Baal. They were unfaithful to God, and God hasn't forgotten them. But I want to tell you something. Now, listen to me. All the fault that Gideon found with God did not flaw the character of God one iota, because God is still God. The flaws that Gideon pointed out that he thought was God only revealed how far Gideon had gotten from God. You get to picking at God, telling God how bad he's been to you and how terrible he's been to you. It only reveals how far we've gotten from God. How far we've gotten from God. The care of God is proclaimed. The care of God is protested. Look at me, please, if you would, about who God reveals himself to. Look in verse number 14. Verse 14 says, "And the Lord said, looked upon him and said, Go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee?" You know, if God delivered Israel, they'd have no problem in believing in God's might, would they? They would have no problem living in God's care if he delivered them. So who was the person that God was going to use? His name's Gideon. Say his name with me. It's what? Gideon. Come on one time. His name is what? Gideon. He's cynical. He's filled with doubts and unbelief. Did you see how cynical he is? Why, if you're with us, why do these always happen? Where's all the miracles? God's forsaken us. You see him? He's an obscure farmer who lived in a small town is all he is. How many farmers do we have here? I'm a farmer. How many farmers we got? Anybody got a farm? How many of you men? I want all the men or women in this church that you own a tractor. I want you to stand up. You own a tractor. Stand up. Now, if you got a tractor, I want to see you stand up for a second. You got a tractor. I want to see you tractor owners. Amen. That's right. Jesse June's got one. All right. You got a tractor. We're comrades. Man, I got a tractor. I love my tractor. Lowell Spencer was telling me a joke. At church, he said this farmer was about to die, and he called his preacher, and he said, preacher said, when I die, I said, I want you to bury me with my John Deere tractor. And the preacher just didn't want any part of it, and finally the man was so insistent, said, you got to bury me with my John Deere tractor. And he said to him, says, okay, I'll bury you with your John Deere tractor, but you got to tell me why. He says, because I've never been a hole that John Deere tractor couldn't pull me out of. Now, I want to just tell you something, that death's a hole too deep for John Deere to get you out of. Amen? But dear Jesus can sure get you out of it, all right? But here's what I want to say to you is this. Could God use someone like Gideon? Can I just tell you something about yourself? And you ought to put this down, right down somewhere. Put this down. That God saw more in Gideon than anybody else saw. That God saw more in Gideon than Gideon saw in himself. Aren't you glad that God doesn't have to look at us in the present and say that's all you are? But God has the ability to look in the future and says that's what you can become. Now, folks, that's good. Let me take an illustration real quickly. Remember when Paul was preaching one night and he was long, the Bible says he was long preaching in Acts chapter 20? And the Bible says he preached till midnight. You love Paul? You want him as your pastor? You'll settle for me? Thanks. I appreciate that. And while he was preaching at midnight, this man fell out of the window. That comforts my heart. If anybody can sleep while Paul's preaching, go ahead and sleep while I am. It's not going to bother me. It's comfort. He falls out of the window and he's laying down and he's dead. Paul looks out the window and sees him. You know what he does? He sees him, but then he goes to where he is, and then he says something about him that no one else in that crowd said. He saw something and nobody else saw. He said his life's still in him. He prayed for him, and God raised him up. You're to thank God for the day when God looked upon you, and he saw more in you than anybody else ever saw. And that's what he did with Gideon. Hey, you look at these young people around here. Man, you don't know what's going to be in them. One of the young men tonight, and I want to thank the young man, the teenager. I like kids. I like being around kids. One of the teenagers, I walk by, and I'm always giving them high fives. I'm their preacher. I love them. I'm not aristocratic where you can't touch me, and I'm not highfalutin. We'll pass the ball. We'll bump shoulders. One of those young teenagers gave me a hand tonight when I came by. You know what he said to me? He gave me the best compliment anybody's ever given me in the last few months. He said, "You're awesome." I looked at him and said, "You're right." I didn't say that. But if I am, it's because God saw something in me that nobody else ever saw. I guarantee that Helen Greer, she's here tonight, he used to spank me and change my diapers. Never said, "Glory to God, I'm holding my pastor." She might have thought John Dillinger, but she didn't think pastor. Right? You know, I've seen God call people that you wouldn't think God'd ever call to do anything. Huh? So don't you look at somebody and disqualify them because you said, boy, from the outward appearance, they'll never make it, because God chooses the weak things of this world to confound the mighty and the base things. Amen? God uses them for his honor and glory. That means there's hope for you. If you'll yield yourself to God, God can use you. But listen to me. I want you to see this point. Listen, boy, this is good now. You got to hear this. If Gideon is defective, and God delivers the people, who gets all the glory? God does. And that's what it's about, is God getting all the glory. May I just say a few things, and I may stop. Don't get your hopes built up. I want to warn a few people tonight. The worst thing that you can ever get in your heart is pride. That you think you've achieved or you've arrived somewhere. Jason, Brad, some of you young preacher boys, Travis. Just because you've got a few invitations to preach, have people to brag on you, don't let it build you up to make you think it's taking you that way. Because it builds you up, it's not taking you that way, it's taking you that way. The greatest mistake young preachers make is the mistake that they're the boss instead of the servant. I'm your servant. Well, let me see if I can just finish this point. We'll pick up here next Sunday night. The commission. It was one of personal, it was a personal call. Lord looked upon Gideon and looked at him and said, I want you. He said, he commanded, he said, I want you to go. He said, have not I sent you? He says, I want you to go in this thy might. When God said to him, go in this thy might, in verse number 14, God wasn't telling Gideon to go in his own strength. He was telling Gideon this. He said, Gideon, you go in the power that I've given you. That's the strength and the ability I've given you. It's a wonderful thing, folks. I don't have to serve God up here in my own energy. My own flesh. Did you know, if you've ever spoken publicly, if you do it in a spiritual sense, you know there's a battle that goes on? If you people teach Sunday school class, you know the frustration sometimes you feel? There's a battle, a constant battle that goes on. And so I have to just confine myself to this reality, that when I step to this place to preach, I do not come here with my own wisdom or my own words or my own wit, because I've not come to you in those words. I've come to you in demonstration of power of the Holy Spirit of God. And that's how we labor. Let me ask you a question. God said, Gideon, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to deliver the children of Israel. I'm going to defeat the Midianites. That's what I'm going to do. And let me ask you a question. Answer me, look this way. Had that happened yet? The answer is no to the question I'm about to ask you. Okay, what's the answer? Okay, has it happened yet? Okay. The next answer is yes. Is it going to happen? Okay, so what Gideon's going to do, he's going to live by faith until it does happen. That's what God asks of you. Is God going to give us the victory? Are we on the winning side? Answer me. Have we actually seen the victor yet? No. Will we someday? So what are we to do? Live by faith. You say, God, we're going to trust you. We're going to believe you. And we're going to walk on and do what you want us to do. I'll stop there. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I got about halfway through. That's half of a sermon. I'll give you the other half next week. God wants us to live by faith, doesn't he? God wants us to trust him. God wants us to believe him. God wants us to yield to him so he can use us. How many tonight just get out of your seat and just come somewhere and kneel and say, God, I want to yield myself. You can use me anywhere you want to. Boy, it's saying a lot. But you'll just be willing to step out of your seat right now and say, God, wherever, however you want to use me, I'm willing to come tonight and ask you to just use me wherever you want to. While they're playing for us on the instruments, you can get out of your seat. You can come. You can kneel and just tell God that. Just like Gideon. I'm sure tonight in a crowd this large, there's somebody here that's never been saved. No one's looking around. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. How many would raise a hand and say, Pastor, I know I'm saved. If you know Christ, would you raise your hand just for a second? Give me a word. Tell me you know Christ. It's good to know Christ, isn't it? Now, I know without even looking around that in a crowd this large, there's some people that you don't know the Lord Jesus. You're not sure if you died, you'd go to heaven. Let me tell you something. What you need is you need a revelation from God. What I mean by that is you need to see Christ. You need to see him where he is and what he did for you, how much he loves you and how much he cares for you. And you need to see yourself as where you are without God. And you need to come to him. What you need in your one condition is you need to get a good look at the Savior. Some of you in an hour of despondency in your life, what you need to do, you need to see God where you are. Some of you are going through trials. You need to look at God. I ask you to come tonight and ask God just to get a fresh glimpse of him. Some of you need to come tonight. Just slip out of your seat right now and just come and say, God, let me get a fresh glimpse of you in my life. Would you ask God for that tonight? You come. And I noticed some hands that was not raised here. You're not sure if you'd die, you'd go to heaven. Would you let me have the privilege of showing you how to know Christ? We're not going to embarrass you. If you couldn't raise your hand, you know you're saved. Would you let me show you how to be saved tonight? If you'd do that, would you just get out of your seat? Would you come on right now and let me show you how you can know Christ? You couldn't raise your hand, you know you're saved, but you ought to be saved. Would you let me have the privilege of showing you Christ? He loves you. He wants to reveal himself to you. Would you come? Not going to embarrass you again, like I said, but why don't you, if you want to need to say to somebody beside you, if you need to go, if you want to go, I'll go with you. If you need to go and pray, I'll go with you. If it's your husband or a wife, a friend, a neighbor, or just someone you've just met, if you need to go, I'll go with you. We're going to sing a verse of that song, just as I am, as we stand. If you need to come, you keep on coming while we stand, while we sing.
Just as I am without one plea,
our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Let me just plead with you just for a moment longer. God revealed himself to you in the person of his son when he came to Bethlehem. As he spoke peace to Gideon in this passage of scripture, he speaks peace to you. Peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Because God wants to give you peace in your heart by knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. Being justified by grace, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know him, you ought to be saved this hour. You ought to come trust him right now. I'm giving you this extended invitation to come to know Christ. Let me meet you here. Take the Bible, show you how you can be saved, how you can know it. If you're here tonight and you're going to get baptized, I want you to go ahead and come forward. If you're here tonight and you need to make public that you've been saved, I want you to come. If you're here and this is the church family you ought to be a part of, I want you to come. You do that now as we sing this verse. Let's sing one more verse, Brother Harvey. You can come.
Just as I am to rid my soul of one dark blood, to thee whose blood can cleanse these spot, O Lamb of God, I come.
Thank you. You can be seated just for a moment. We're going to baptize some people that's been saved. Do you have an announcement? Okay, if you'll come and make that, and then I'll be ready in just a second.
Well, just 2 weeks from today, the juniors and teens will be headed for the Bill Rice Ranch, but not in an air-conditioned motor coach. So you pray for us. Now, I do ask that you pray for the safety as we travel and while we're at camp, for the spiritual needs of our juniors and teens that will be attending camp that week, and pray for the counselors who will be going to work with our teens. Now, I do need a man to go and work with our junior boys. If you'd pray about that and someone would like to go, I sure could use you. I've already given out the registration forms to our juniors, and if any junior needs a form, I have extras, and I'll be giving them out to the teens tonight. And I need you to turn in your form and your fee next Sunday, if at all possible. If you make out a check, please make it out to Mount Pisgah. And if anyone needs financial assistance, all you have to do is speak with me. And I need to meet with all the teens who are going to camp just for a few minutes tonight, right here in the choir, right after church. I just have a few things to go over with you. I know some of you will be going into the Bible school meeting, but we'll be brief. So just meet with us for a few moments.
I'm going to baptize in just a moment, but Stephen Trail, who's worked with us for these last 2 years, I try to encourage our young men to put hands-on experience of learning things. He's going to baptize his first two he was ever baptized in his life. I want you to pray for him that they'll come out all right. And so Stephen's going to do that. And as quick as he baptizes, I'll change and I'll baptize also.
Tasha Wells, and we have Tia Wells coming in just a moment, and they've been coming faithfully, very, very faithfully every week, and we appreciate their faithfulness. Last week they came to Brother Tom and said they need to be saved, and so we thank the Lord for that. Tasha, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the blessed Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Risen to walk in newness of life. Amen. This is Tia Wells. Tia, upon your profession of faith in Jesus Christ and in obedience to our Lord's command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the blessed Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism. Risen to walk in newness of life.
Turn to 246. We'll sing one verse of Redeemed, How I Love to Proclaim It. 246. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
I want his family to stand up. Let's come to watch him get baptized tonight. Amen. And they're here. That's wonderful. Amen. I appreciate these folks coming to our church.
Amen.
I'm glad Kevin got saved, aren't you?
Amen.
Kevin, love you, son. You're special to God, and I want you to know that. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. buried with Christ in baptism. There's no walk in units of life. Did a good job, partner. Good job. God bless you. That's good. You missed a verse, Brother Hartman will be out.
Got two more verses. Verse 3. I think of